So let us look at what is HTML, CSS and JavaScript and what are the roles they do in front-end web development. The first one, you see HTML stands for Hypertext Markup Language. Okay, you see the color that characters in blue, HTML, that's how the abbreviation is created. So this HTML is used for defining the structure of the web page. So analogous is like all of us human beings, we have the bones inside our body, right? So these bones, the structure, so these bones and how they are arranged, how they are connected to each other and where they are placed, where the top, bottom or middle. So this defines like our human skeleton. So human skeleton defines the structure of our human body. Similarly, HTML is used to define the structure of a web page. And let's come to a JavaScript. JavaScript, they are like, so see, once you have the skeleton, so that's not makes you a complete man. You need to have muscles, because muscles are the ones which actually, when they contract or expand, that will cause the movement of these, the bones or the limbs. And so analogously, JavaScript, if you have to do dynamically update in a web page, some portion of a web page, or if you need interactivity with the user, and that is where we need JavaScript. And the last one is CSS. CSS stands for Cascading Style Sheet. So we'll just understand, once we are discussing about CSS, then in the later modules, I'll explain what the cascading means. But for now, just remember it's a cascading style sheet. As the name suggests, you can see the style sheet. So these are the sheets or files which will define the styling of the HTML page. So using this CSS, you can define or you can design the presentation on or styling of the web page. Analogously, just like if you have skeletons and muscles, or probably on top of it you have skin to cover the muscles, and then so that's not good enough. So you have to present it in a decent, in a professional manner to the end user. So on that body, if you put proper dress, tie and shoes, okay, and that's when the human body becomes presentable to others. And CSS exactly does that presentation on top of HTML web pages. Okay, so these are the fundamental roles played by HTML, CSS and JavaScript. Because this is very fundamental and you need to understand what each one is capable of doing it. Note that since HTML is for defining the structure of the page, and you have to use HTML strictly for defining the structure of the page. Note that there will be some tags in HTML which are deprecated, or which are like, for example, styling is like putting something as bold. Okay, that is styling. So there might be some tags, but as far as possible, you should not use that unless otherwise necessary. But most of the time, if you have to do styling, then you have to use only CSS. That is a recommended practice. Some of you said that again, what is the professional way of doing the programming? So this is one of the tip. So any styling, you have to do it completely in CSS and not in the HTML, because HTML is only for structure. If it is not a structure, if you are doing styling in HTML, then you are doing something wrong. So then remove from the HTML and then move it into CSS which does the styling. Yeah, so we said that HTML is a hypertext markup language. When you said markup, so then the question comes, what are these markup components? So as the word communicates, markup means, so you mark the portions of this page to be treated differently. Something you want to be treated as a paragraph, something you want to be treated as a heading. So you mark them as a beginning at the beginning of it and at the end of it. So each of these different components, different sections of the web page, you mark them at the starting, at the end, are individual things. So since you are marking, you are basically doing some markup on these different portions of the web page, so that's why it's called markup language. So yeah, as I said, we talked about what constitutes a HTML document or HTML page. Basically, HTML document consists of, HTML document is more a technical term. HTML element is a technical term. Whereas HTML web page and web document is a little informal terms. That's the only difference. So I'll keep switching between technical terms and non-technical terms. So if both mean the same. So HTML document will consist of one or more HTML elements. Okay, so what is how do you let's look at what constitutes the markup components. Basically, you can do markup of the page using these four things. The first and most frequently used markup component is called HTML tag. So HTML tag is identified less than symbol and greater than symbol, and in between what that markup tag is. So in this case, HTML is the tag name, and the second case, H1 stands for heading 1, and P stands for paragraph. And so these are called start tags. And the end tag, most of the HTML tags, they'll be matching end tag. So what you see here is the start tags. The end tags will be same as start tags. Just before the tag name, you'll see slash. That we'll see in the next slide. So that's it called end tag. And then another component of this markup is what is called tag attributes. So on inside this tags, start tags, you can specify multiple attributes to this tag. Those attributes could be named as ID, which stands for identifier, name, class. So the way to specify the value for a attribute is basically tag attributes specified like the class, which is this class attribute, equal to, followed by the value. In this case, menu, which is generally specified inside the double quotes. So within double quotes, menu, that is called value, and the class is called attribute. Tag attribute name. This is value. And the next component, markup component, is called character reference. Character reference basically means it's a sometimes note that we are HTML uses characters called less than and greater than symbols. Let us say inside the text, if you want to define, if you want to display less than and greater than symbol, how do you do it? Because if as soon as it sees less than symbol, the browser thinks that it is a tag. So you need to distinguish between the tag and something which you want to display as is. So then this character references will be of help. So if you basically this is, you can treat it as an alias, which has got the same meaning as the character is, rather than special meaning which is there in case of a tag. So if you want to refer, if you want to display ampersand character, then you should see ampersand, AMP, semicolon. So if whatever is specified displayed in I'm showing in the blue color, if you give that, then so whatever is showed here in the red color, that's what get displayed in the browser. Similarly, if you want to display double quote, you have to give ampersand character, QUOT, quote, or semicolon. Similarly, if you want to give less than, so here ampersand LT stands for less than and GT stands for greater than. I'll demonstrate this. And similarly, there is something called entity references. Like for example, same thing, note that here in character references, you are referring to the character using again alphabets. Whereas in entity references, those same characters you'll be referring using hexadecimal numbers like this. Here this X stands for hexadecimal, okay, and here this 30 is a decimal 38. This is decimal 38, and note that all these references, they start with ampersand. So in case of a decimal, this followed ampersand followed by hash defines what this value 38 is in decimal. And if it is, if you want to specify the same value 38 in hexadecimal, then you have to prefix with X, then 26. Note that hexadecimal 26 is equal to decimal 38. So let's demonstrate this as a first thing. Yeah, so this is the code which I'll be using for demonstration. Okay, so let me just take. Okay, so note that this is the HTML page. We'll come to that doc type little later. And note that here I talked about HTML tag. This is a start tag. This is an end tag. And just for the clarity's sake, I have done indentation, but indentation is not necessary. Indentation is required for us humans, programmers. But for a browser and for machines, indentation is not required. They will ignore all this indentation, they will just skip it. So just for clarity's sake, we have put the indentation, but we should always do the indentation when you write the programs, because we write the programs for other programmers and humans. So here this has got head tag. Again, head tag starts here and ends here. Note that end tag always just before the tag name, you see the slash character. And this is the body element. Note that here this is called head element, this whole thing whatever I marked. So that is one element. So yeah, let me start from the beginning. HTML is one element which contains two sub elements, head element and body element. So this body element starts with the body tag and ends with this body tag. And whatever we see in the browser has to be specified only in the body tag. Whatever we specify inside head tag, it is meant for the browser. So browser use this information in rendering the page. But whatever user want to see or you want to show to the end user, then that should be specified inside the body tag only. Only this, that elements which you put it in body tag will get displayed. The elements. And see, note that I have one paragraph tag. And here is another paragraph element. And I'm just copying this into the file full path into a clipboard and opening a browser and pasting it here. So this is the place. See ya. So the first line is the first paragraph element. Second one is the second paragraph element. Okay, and we were talking about let's say now I would like to define. So let me just put this as a destruction. I'll put it outside. Let us say now I want to display this is something like this is the demo for p tag. Okay, in the Edureka course. Note that my intention is that I want to be displayed, this whole thing should be displayed in the browser, including the tag in the Edureka course. Let us save it and then render it. I'm doing a refresh. You can see here, this is a demo for, and I wanted this p tag less than p and then greater than, so that is not displayed. So that is skipped and only the tag in the Edureka course is displayed. So this did not achieve my purpose. This is not getting displayed. This is because as soon as see there is a this p tag is same as this p tag. Okay, sorry. Yeah, here the start tag is whole thing is a start tag. Let me just keep it simple. Okay, yeah, the same thing. Note that, so this is the start of paragraph tag, and this is also paragraph tag. So how do you see the way it is treated as, this whole thing is treated as one paragraph, and the second one is treated as second paragraph. That's the reason why it is showing as two lines. But my intention is not that. So I would like these less than greater than to be displayed as is. So the only way to do is using the, so note that ampersand LT less than, and the, so this is again ampersand GT semicolon. So I'm using the character references. Now let me just refresh it. You see here, this is what I wanted. So if you want to give display the character as is without its special meaning, then you need to use the this character entities. Note that I'm using the character entity here, but you can as well use the other as well. Let's say here less than is, so I'll just copy this. Okay, so instead of this, I'll just replace this alone. So note that, so the here I'm specifying using hexadecimal x3c, which means again less than character. This is with hexadecimal character entities. Okay. So it's called entity reference, character entity reference. Fine. So note that I added new text, and now this character entity reference will be interpreted as the same less than. You see here, same less than, but now the additional text is also displayed. And yeah, note that I am here displaying as a hexadecimal. You can still specify the same thing as this decimal value, that is 16. So again, I'm replacing this. So not hexadecimal, but just a decimal. Decimal. I'll just remove this decimal entity. So decimal entity reference. Now let me just go and refresh it. See here, demo for with decimal entity reference. Note that, so the same less than character can be specified using hexadecimal entity reference or decimal entity reference or character entity reference. Three ways you can specify it. It's all your convenience. So is that clear, the entity reference? Because this is the one thing which, I mean, entity references is one thing which most of the web programmers don't use it correctly. So see, most of the time, I mean, if it is a character, see, one of my recommended ways of using this entity reference is, if there is a character reference, use a character reference, because it is easy to read. And for example, it's easy to read AMP rather than these numbers, because it's very hard for someone to remember the numbers. Like for example, if you say hexadecimal 3C or decimal 60, you don't know what it is. But if you reference this under ampersand LT, you know that, okay, LT means less than, GT means greater than. So whoever is reading your code, they can understand easily. So if there is a character reference, use a character reference. Entity reference you can use only in case of a Unicode. Unicode is like for, you know that, okay, EBCDIC code and ASCII code for these are the codes for these characters, what we see on our keyboard and special characters. But for different languages, like these languages like say Urdu and like Japanese, Chinese, and Indian languages like Telugu, Kannada, Tamil. So these languages, they don't have codes in ASCII. So for that, the IETF has, I think basically standardization bodies has defined what is called Unicode. Basically, it's like Unicode stands for probably Universal Code or Uniform Code. So this Unicode basically know that the, our characters are represented as a 7 bits or 8 bits in case of EBCDIC. So whereas in Unicode has got 16 bits, with 16 bits you can have almost 65,000 plus the characters. I think since there's including all the languages on the world, so we don't have 65,000 characters, alphabets. So all of them have been accommodated, and each of them have been given a code, Unicode. So which is a 2 byte or 16 bits code. So when you are using those codes, then you can you have to use obviously either hexadecimal notation or decimal notation. Hope that is clear. So we'll demonstrate that a little later. I hope these entities and how to use, what to use when. Hope that's clear now. Okay, how to execute the HTML? Okay, fine. See, there's, you don't execute, it's not called execution. You should call it, in case of HTML, you should call it rendering. So it is called rendering. Rendering HTML. Okay. So it is called rendering. I think all of you got it. So rendering means basically displaying it. See, the way to render the page is just like you open the page inside the browser. Since this is the full path. Like for example, so go to, let me go here. Where's my page? Yeah, this is my demo page. Okay, this is what I'm. So this is a place, like if you open it in a text browser, this is the code what you see. This is HTML code. For now, just forget about this doc type. We'll come to that later. So this is our HTML page. So what you do is, you go to, so this is present in this directory. So that full path, okay? And then this file name. You can see here, the file means this is a local file. And there's a three hashes, and then so the drive on which it is present, and the full path to the directory, and then file name. So how I got is, if you want to do it, you have to do it manually. You have to type in all this. So just rather than typing, what I do is here in the notepad, I go and do, take the full path of this file into clipboard. So it copied into my Windows clipboard. And I open a browser, since it is copied there, whenever you do paste, control V, the whole path you see here, the whole path is pasted here. Then you just enter, that's it, enter. So now that file is open, and now the browser renders that page. That's all. Yeah, in case of PHP, PHP script you have to execute. You have to execute on a web browser. Sorry, not web browser, web server. So then the execution of PHP script on a web server will generate a HTML page, something like this, what we see in this notepad. So it will generate this as output, and that output is sent on the internet, which is destined to your web browser or your machine, and then your web browser, and then your web browser takes it and then renders it. The way I'm doing it now, copy pasting into this URL input, and then it renders it. That's all. Yeah. So that's how you render HTML page. I hope all of you now understand references. So you might be wondering where these references are defined. So let me just show that. So just go to our friend Google. Okay, then you should type in character HTML character references, search for it. Okay, and you see here character entity reference chart, and you can just browse this, and so these are all the entity references. Note that I was talking about W3 Consortium, World Wide Web Consortium. Its official web page is this, w3.org. So these are all officially defined the character references. You can see for exclamation symbol, it is ampersand EXEL and so on. And the same thing, hexadecimal and decimal value is also shown. Okay. So here you can just go on, see all of these. You can see the entity references. So note that some of them are displayed as block, the rectangles, squares, because of why this browser is not able to render that character. That's the reason it's just showing as a block, as squares. But in some other scenarios, so it might be possible to render that character. Note that even the telephone symbol, the music symbol, all these are also have got the entity references. For example, most frequently used is what is called copy. So note that each of these in our website will display what is called copyright symbol, right? So that copyright symbol is, so you see here this symbol. So ampersand copy, you'll get to display your copyright symbol. This is how you do. So irrespective of which browser, which operating system you use, when you specify this character reference, the browser is obligated to display this character, what you see. Basically, C within the circle. Similarly, registered trademark, like R within the circle is also ampersand REG semicolon. Or you can just go through it, all these character references. And similarly, so basically all these are defined in what is called document type definition. So here, this is another place where you can see all defined entity references. Note that here you can just search for COPY. Yeah, you can see here. So just forget about this C data. So the copy entity reference is this one. So all these are defined in what is called DTD, document type definition. And you can see all these character and entity references in this, which are part of HTML standard. Note that, like for example, other scripts like Chinese, Tamil, and Indian languages, they have their own Unicodes. Even those Unicodes also can be specified as entity references, but they are not present inside this standard because this entity references only are part of HTML4 or HTML5 standard. So the next one is what is, see, we talked about what are the different components which are used for doing the markup in HTML, and one of the component for markup is tags. So tag is just a text so the purpose of using these tags is you mark some textual information using these tags to give a different meaning. For example, the example of these tags is like HTML and P. When I say tag, you always remember, okay, it should start with less than and it should end with greater than. So that is a tag. Both start tag and end tags also start and end with the same less than, greater than symbols. Okay. Some people might call them as angle brackets. Okay. Left angle bracket, right angle bracket, but it's just essentially less than and greater than characters. Yeah. So the start tag has got a structure. So one, the structure is less than character and then a tag name. Tag is basically, it's a placeholder for a name, which could be like HTML, P for paragraph, and H1 for heading 1 and so on. So tag, and then basically the name of the tag, followed by greater than symbol. So this is a simple tag which does not have any attributes. So like in this case, in this case we have the P tag, right? So this doesn't have attribute, this is a start tag. And similarly, the end tag is here. This is the end tag. Note that difference between end tag and start tag is only this, the forward slash character before the tag name. That's the only difference. Everything else is the same. If it doesn't have any attributes. But if it has attributes, then, so after tag name, you have to give the attribute list. Sorry. So the one which is displayed in the yellow text, that attribute list, that's where you define the list of attributes, and then followed by the greater than symbol, which is the end of the tag, start tag. Note that here I use different colors, like less than and tag is defined, I'm showing in blue color, the greater than in the red color. What it means is the group of characters which is in the same color, that defines a token. Token is a sequence of characters which has got a special meaning for the browser. And in between the tokens, means between this token, blue token and the red token, you can have empty white space. White space means the blank spaces or tab spaces or new line spaces as well. And here note that this is a start tag, and I have here empty space and one attribute name which I call attr1. This is just a placeholder, the equal to sign, and then so note that between equal to sign and either side I have given blank space, means you can have white space or you can avoid the white space as well, but generally it's better to avoid white space in between around this equal to, and then double quote and value of this attribute 1, and again space here and so on. Whenever I've shown white space, means white space is valid, but I'll show even what is the recommended way of doing things, but this is the completely valid. Note that after this double quote also you can have white space, and this whole thing constitutes the start tag. Okay, so in case of an end tag, so note that here in this case also the att attribute 1 is at one token, equal to is a token, double quote is a quote, and value is a token, and so on. Token means around the token you can have white space. Okay, and end tag, note that end tag I defined the blue color is less than, slash, and tag. So the three components makes one token, and greater than is another token. Okay, and so on. You can just play with it by giving white space and not giving white space, and you'll be able to understand it. So token is a concept used in compilers. Basically, whenever we use this, when these browsers also, when they have to interpret, when they have to render, they have to understand what is specified inside the HTML. See, the programs and computers doesn't have brains, so they need to understand. So the using tokens, you communicate the meaning of what it is. Okay, note that these tags are case sensitive. What it means is, these whatever the tag name, you can define in uppercase letters, lowercase letters, mixed case, but that's your choice. But don't use mixed case because it will be very awkward. Either use uppercase or lowercase consistently across the HTML file. So that I'll demonstrate. Note that this HTML, you can just now I give it as the upper lowercase. You can give like this. Note that you can mix one starting tag, uppercase, end tag, lowercase. That's also fine. But as I said, keep it consistent. That's all. So this got all the same meaning. You can give like this as well, body, and here P also you can give uppercase P, and here also uppercase P. So just keep it consistent across. So this is, I'll say this is demo is with uppercase HTML tags. Okay, you see here I render it. So yeah, for a browser, whether it's uppercase or lowercase, it doesn't matter. That's what I mean, case insensitive. Okay, that's what I mean, case insensitive. So both are same. So note that, so for HTML and body and few other tags, basically the start and end tags are optional. But it's highly recommended, okay, you should put it. And so title tag is mandatory. If it is present, you should have both start tag and end tag. What it means is, so just for this demo sake, what I'll do is I'll strip off a lot of code. I'll remove this, and I'll remove this, and I'll remove this head. I'll remove this head as well. I'll remove this body, and everything. So this demo is without HTML and body tags at all. Note that my file, see, note that here this is the just a comment, means which is ignored by it. So my HTML page is only this. So if you want, I can delete even this as well. So note that that's all it contains, and you can, the browser will still be able to render it. So that's what I mean, the optional. So note that, so let's say even this title need not be present, even this is also fine, the same thing. So even without title tag, see, same thing. So let's even remove this as well. Without p tag, see, it's able to even render it. So note that even this is also HTML page, because you are given extension .html, that's why it's able to render it. Okay, I'll just undo all of it. That's what I mean. All these tags are optional, but I mean it's a good practice that you should use these tags, because it's highly recommended. Okay, yeah, it's fine. So the minimum is definitely you should have HTML tag, head tag. So title you can remove it, it's not required, and link also need not be there, or even whole red also can be absent, and definitely it should have body. Okay, and for each paragraph you should have paragraph as well. That's what I mean. So see, title tag is mandatory, means I mean if you have a title, so you have to have it like this. So you cannot have, see, note that I removed the end tag. If you do that, then see nothing is displayed. That's because I removed the end tag, the title tag end. I mean, no, I just put it back, and you can see, you know, it's able to display. That's because if the end title tag is not present, then the browser will not display, because that's why it's mandatory if it's present. But if you don't want title, you can remove this title, but still it will render it, that's fine. But if it is present, end tag should be marked. Like for example, paragraph tag, even if you remove this p tag, like say this is without end p tag, this is fine. So because its end tag for paragraph is optional, see, okay, that's what I mean by optional. Yeah, here the next one is we talked about is character data types. Yeah, 1 minute. The tags is fine. There are other components which are actually called character data types, which are enclosed within a script tag. Basically, inside the script tag has got its own end tag. Whenever I say end tag, means it is slash script here. So you enclose JavaScript code inside a script tag, and you, let's say if you want to define a style for the web page, that is enclosed within a style tag. So that I'll demonstrate a little later. Note that inside the style tag, so these two, whatever you enclose in within script tag and style tag, those are called character data types in HTML. And inside the style tag, you can have CSS defined in 2.1 or version 3. So only thing is the browser should support. So if browser doesn't support CSS version 3, then it will ignore some of the styles which it doesn't understand. So there is something called a doc type declaration. So this, see, basically the browser should know what is the what do you call words used in the HTML language. Like each of us, like English and Indian language, each language, Chinese, they have some words, right? I mean, so a sequence of alphabets will constitute a word. So those words will have a special meaning. So similarly, HTML is also a language, and a sequence of characters will have the form a word of the language, which has got a special meaning. Those words are defined in what is called document type definition, DTD. So this DTD is what is specified in the as the first line. So this DTD specification is mandatory in HTML 4.01, where in HTML 5 it is optional, or it is very simplified. Not optional, it is very simplified. Basically, DTD definition is deprecated in HTML 5, but it is required in HTML 4.01. If you don't specify it, then a browser will assume what is called quirks mode, which is it depends on the browser, and it's got its own meaning for interpreting the document. But if you give it specifically, then it will render the page as per the HTML 4.01 standard. In HTML 5, the same DTD, in HTML 4.01 DTD is very complex. I'll show it in the later slides. Where in HTML 5 it is simplified just like this. What is shown in the blue text, that's what is you need to define as doc type. That's all. So I'll just copy paste here. See, in HTML 4 you have to define this long, very complicated. So doc type, HTML, you should say it's a public. I should give W3C this one, and then this you should say it's version 4.01. It is English language, and then URL where the strict DTD is present. So you can just copy paste this and open in a browser and see what is there inside that. I'm pasting in a browser. Basically, this is called very strict DTD as per the HTML 4.01. Note that it is coming from w3c.org. It looks like the server is very loaded, that's why it has not come. See, now it has come. So this is the whole DTD. This is where the language of HTML is defined. Okay, this is also a plain text file. So this is mandatorily is required if you have to write HTML 4.01 documents. But whereas, let's say if you want to define HTML 5 page, then you can just do it like this. So just like this. Yeah, doc type. So this whole thing, this complication is all removed. And this is HTML5. That's all. In HTML5, it is just simplified like this. So if you look at this, and if you see this in a page, then you can see it's a HTML5 page. By just looking at the doc type declaration, you can tell whether it's a 4.01 page or HTML5 page. So next thing, which we'll be frequently using is what is called HTML comments. So basically, comment is, if you're familiar with other programming languages or scripting languages, note that each of those languages will define some characters sequence for defining the comments. Yeah, it's because these are the concepts. I need to make sure. Yeah, so I'll just. Yeah. So comments are defined using less than and exclamation and hyphen hyphen and hyphen hyphen greater than. Okay. Let's do that. So whatever you define in this block, it is ignored by the HTML page. So I defined comment like this. Let us say you want to say this is a page. So now this is displaying this content. Let's say if you want to now comment it out. So what you can do is you can enclose less than exclamation minus minus and then so this one minus minus exclamation. So note that these are the comment. This is the start of comment. This is the end of comment. So note that once I commented that line, so if you refresh it, nothing is displayed. So if you want to delete some code temporarily and browser doesn't need to display it, then you need to use these comment characters. I hope comments are clear. So another word of caution is don't nest the comments. like this. So you have a comment starting here, ending here. Within that, you should not put another comment, because if you do that, then it will treat only this as the comments and this will be displayed as is. You can try it out. Yeah. And the HTML element, basically the structure of start element is this is a start tag, and so I said the attributes. It will have a start tag, it will have attributes. So attribute here is this one. ID is the attribute, and the content is what is get displayed. And this is the end tag. So let's take as is and then let's see. So I'll just put it here. Note that this page is not displaying anything. I'll put it now. So now you should be able to see hello world. See. So yeah, basically the element content contains the text to be displayed in the browser. Any new lines are there ignored. And if you want to break a line, see, if you break a line like this, okay, say like this, and still even you will not see the breaks inside the browser. You see, it's the same. If you want to break a line, the way to do is using what is called BR character, break character. So that is the importance of this BR. So note that BR you should give like this BR. I'm just copying the same thing and giving a BR here. So and then if you render it, you get the line break. So you have to use always the BR characters to enter the line breaks. And let's say if you want to give spaces, let's say sometimes if you want to give spaces, then let's say rather than if you give any spaces like this, you will not be able to see those pages, like those spaces. But if you want to give the spaces, you have to explicitly give these characters. So NB stands for, so NBSP, non-blank space. So that's how you get it. So that is the use of NBSP. Okay, is that clear? Use of, so as I said, this is the structure of the HTML element. Start tag, these are the attributes, this is the start tag. Note that start tag constitutes the whole thing. And then the content and then end tag. Okay. So here I said, I mean, there is something called iframes, which are not, they are supported in HTML5, but I mean, you should not use it, because I mean, the rendering of these iframes differs from browser to browser. And also sometimes if you, the page, what you're displaying is got responsive web page, then it will not be rendered properly. There's something called frame set, which are not supported in HTML5. Okay. And you have seen, this is the structure of simple HTML page, which you have seen already. And this is also we already covered. If this doc type is absent, then it goes into a quirks mode. And there are multiple DTDs, like called strict DTD, translational DTD, and frameset DTDs. Okay. So which we already briefly covered. So you can read this, because this is all theory. I mean, someone who is a purist, it will be easy. You will appreciate it, what these DTDs means. Yeah. Let's move on to module 1.2. So I'll just skip it. So here, I mean, we already talked about HTML tags, right? You know, you have seen HTML tags. You can basically visualize as this is called root tag. Root tag has got children, head and body. And each of these will have, again, its own children or sub-elements. And visually, you can just visualize like this. HTML is a bigger, big container. And inside that, you have small sub-containers like head container and body container. Within body container, you can have again sub-containers or sub-elements. Okay. And here I have shown the structure of a start tag pictorially. The same thing which I explained, start tag, content and end tag. And the attribute value. And only one thing is here, class is an attribute, and for class you can have more than one value. Here you can see foo, foo 1, 2, 3, and multiple values also can be present on class. And yeah, this is how the browser stores that tag information. It'll show like what is the type and what is the type of the tag and so on. This is the structure, the data structure in which the browser stores when it browses the HTML page. I think people who are familiar with programming, they'll appreciate this. Yeah, the head tag will contain any of these tags: base tag, link, meta, object, script, style tag, and title tag. Note that these tags should be present inside the head tag. Visually, you can visualize them as the head tag being outside container and inner tags being the subcontainers. Or you can visualize the head being at the root, and all of them are the children. So the purpose of base tag is, if you want to specify a relative path, then you use the base tag. Note that it does not have an end tag. Let me demonstrate using that. So so now I want to display Edureka logo. So it is there in directory ed. I'll show here. Note that I have a directory called ed here. So inside that I have this logo. So I would like to display this logo. Since I'm referring, my document is present in this directory, this demo.html. So with respect to this directory structure, you have to specify the path for this. So that's why it's defined as ed slash and edureka logo. So let me display that. You see here? So since it is a big logo, so it is defined, it is displayed 100%. And hello world is displayed at the bottom. Okay. So if you want to make it smaller, then you should display as, you should specify as width is equal to 200, and then height is equal to 100. So then it will display smaller. Okay. So note that if you want, rather than giving that this directory path, you would like to use that as the base. So you have to specify this in the within the head tag. Here, this is how you define it. Note that you specify the relative to this ed directory, all other paths should be interpreted. Then you can delete ed here. And then, so it displays the same thing. Note that if you delete this base tag, so it is not able to find the image. So that's why you see these are the broken image. This is normally you see some of the websites where the images are broken. Because they moved that files to another directory, that's why you'll see like this. The way to fix it is, either you specify ed here, or you specify the base tag. So this base is used as a base for all other relative paths. Is that clear? Base tag. So link tag, if it is you can have zero or more link tags, but if it is present, so you can specify any of these ways. Link tag used for specifying the style sheets. If you remember, I talked about styling the your HTML elements. So I'll just demonstrate only the one. So it's here. So you can specify that, okay, the styling to be used on this paragraph, p tag. I'll just remove this image because for this paragraph, hello world. So this is the content. And I'll remove this no blank spaces as well. And that's how get displayed. Let us say if you want to specify some style on this. Let us say I want to display this text in blue color. So I should not be doing it in the HTML. So I should do it in my style sheet, which is defined in this. So let me open that style sheet. So this is inside my CSS folder, and I'm opening that CSS. Note that this paragraph, the way you specify is, you can specify like this, P. P stands for the tag. What you, this tag name, you have to specify here, P. And then color, this is text color, and you want red. And so since this is in a separate file, you need to link it using the link. This one here, this relationship REL stands for relationship, and href stands for hypertext reference, which is inside a folder, and this is a file, and I am refreshing it. Note that it didn't get displayed. You know why? Because I have the base tag. With respect to the ED, say since the base is present, it'll try to search in this directory which is not existent. That's the reason why you have to delete this base and save it and refer it again. So now it is in blue, red color. And if you want a green color, you can change it to here green. That's and same style sheet and just render it again. You get green color. So that is how you can use the link to the external style sheet. Similarly, there's a favorite icon which will get displayed in the browser here. You hear the Twitter icon here, so that's how it gets displayed. So, yeah, so let's go back to the slides. Similarly, the meta tag is used for providing additional information about the document like author, publication, and expiration. The way to specify it is, the code is given here. So see, the meta information is only earlier it was used by search engines, but nowadays the importance of these is reduced drastically. Only useful thing nowadays is this meta character UTF-8, because you need to define what is the character set which is used in this HTML web page. That's the reason why only this char set meta tag is used nowadays. All others are only for additional information, but even if they are absent, there is no loss of functionality. Okay, let's move on to the module 1.3. So see, we talked about what is the tag, what is the how to specify attribute, so attribute name and attribute value, and as you can see here, so input is one tag wherein you specify required is a attribute, type is an attribute, and so on. Note that even attributes and values, they can be uppercase or lowercase. Fine. So I think I did talk about this. Note that these attribute values are the case sensitive. And there are these five types of attributes like ID, class, style, title, and direction. So these are called core attributes of elements. And ID, if it is present, it has to be unique. Unique means if ID is there in first one, it should be like first and second. You cannot use first and first here. Whereas in case of a class, you can have same class value. That is, line is the value of the class. And here also, same value of class. So here, classes can be present on multiple HTML elements, whereas ID value has to be unique. Okay. And style is attribute where whatever you specify the style in the CSS external CSS file, if you want to specify inside the element itself, you can define like this. The same thing. Only difference is that inside, so this is my external style sheet. So basically, this square brackets and then this tag name will be missing. And rest of this content should be specified as the value of this style attribute. So then it will apply the style. Let me just give this style here. I think you can just copy paste this code into the HTML browser. You can play with it, and it will display the color. So title, as I said, I mean, if you give a title, so I'll just demonstrate this one thing. So note that if you put a cursor here, nothing is displayed. But if you define under this paragraph tag, if you define title equal to Edureka. So whatever the title is displayed here, so it'll come here. You see here Edureka, so that is tooltip. So this tooltip behavior varies from the browser to browser, but you should test it and use it. So that is the purpose of that title attribute. So when I say core attribute, means it is present in most of the HTML elements. So that is the purpose of title attribute. And so this is direction attribute. It is like, say, most of the language, like English language, is from left to right. When you specify left to right, then so direction attribute, you have to specify like this, LTR. So if you don't specify, the default value is left to right, because most of the languages are left to right when you are writing it. But there are some languages like Arabic and Hebrew, so which you have to write from right to left, then you have to give here RTL, right to left. So I'll just demonstrate this language. So if you want to display the characters of different language, then you have to use the lang attribute. Lang stands for language. So I'll demonstrate this here. Sorry for the people who do not read Kannada language, because I thought most of the people will be from Karnataka. That's why I given this. Note that here I given the language, KN stands for Kannada. So this is the Unicode characters of Kannada script. When you display it in browser, you see here, this is a Kannada script. So like this, you can give, you can specify what is the language, or you can give Unicode of it, then you can define, you can display the script of that language. This will be useful when you are doing the international, for a different language, if you want to develop, you have to use this language feature, language attribute. In the attributes, basically these attributes are some are core attributes, which is applicable for most of the attributes, most of the elements, and some attributes which will be applicable only for certain elements. For example, here input is an element which has got the specific attributes called autofocus, max length, size, pattern, and placeholder. These are the element attributes which are applicable for only input element. They are not applicable for other elements. So similarly here, the list is also another attribute which is applicable for only when you are defining the data list. Okay, and there are some attributes for defining the for associating a JavaScript code with an element using on blur, on mouse, on submit, and these attributes. So probably once when we are demonstrating JavaScript, at that time we'll be using these event attributes. Yeah. So next comes the heading at heading elements. So heading elements, the by default HTML defines the six heading types: heading 1, 2, 3 until 6, and the browsers have got the standard style for these headings. For example, the way to use is like this. Let us use these headings. I'm just copy pasting that same code. So note that I have three headings here. So let me display this. See here. Note that national news is heading 1. This is heading 2, heading 3. This is the default font and size which it is using for these headings. If you want to change the style, then you have to go and use the external style sheet and define like this. Here you can say font size, you make it 20 pixels, and then for heading 2 and heading 3. For heading 2, I'll make it as 16 pixels. For a heading 3, I'll make 10 pixels. And note that by default, the browser displayed this font, these font sizes. But once I define the styles, when you run it again, you see it's reduced. So that's how you can style. And similarly, you can style, you can change the font. You can even, let's say, if you want in different color, like this color and then red. And here you can give it as color blue and render it. It will change the colors. So like this, now all the styling on these elements, note that this defines only structure, but what color, what font, everything you define in the style sheets. Okay. That's about headings. So we talked about paragraphs and what is the start tag, end tag, and you can just, we also talked about the no breaking space. Note that in HTML page, you can have one or more headings or one or more paragraph elements. Yeah, there's another concept called the block elements and inline elements. The block elements is the ones which, like for example, if you see each one of them, so this is this row is taking the one full line, this whole block, and this one is also taking whole block. So since it is taking one full stretch of along the in the browser window, so those are called the block elements. So all these elements are the block elements. So let's say by default, I'll just say, so now you can change, I mean, this is a default behavior, but if you want to change this default behavior of it, you can change like this. So there's another concept called inline elements. If you want H1 as inline element, you just go and say display inline, and you can change the style using display here. So you can define on all of these. Yeah, note that since I defined all of them as inline elements, all of them came on the same line. So that's how you can control the default behavior of the elements. By default, there will be block elements, and you can make inline elements block and block elements inline by using the display property. And these are the inline elements by default. So anchor, image, span, input, and all these. Those are the inline elements by default. But if you want to enforce using CSS, you have to define using display inline. That's what I did here. I'm enforcing the heading 1, heading 2, heading 3, which are the block elements. I'm enforcing them using CSS. If you want to make them invisible, you can just add this property hidden and it will become hidden. So there's two ways of doing things. One, you can add here itself, you can add here hidden here itself. So note that heading will be hidden now. One minute. Yeah, so I think heading one it doesn't work. So let me use on paragraph. Just a minute. Yeah, sorry, there's a spelling mistake. So I entered 3 D's. Say DDN. So note that, so that will be hidden. Okay. So another way to hide is using CSS. That is another way of hiding things. So you can use a display none or visibility hidden. So one difference between, let me just demonstrate this. I'll remove this inline. and render it. So now you got these two. See, now I want to say here display none. When you say display none, means so heading 2, note that it appears as though it doesn't exist. Whereas, so if you use visibility hidden, visibility hidden, note that there is a more space. The difference is, I mean, when you say display visibility hidden, means the element exists here, the heading 2 exists, but it is not displayed, it is hidden. Whereas in case of display none, means it as though that element is not there in HTML at all, it's completely removed. That's why, so you will not see the space. That's the difference between these two. So here, sorry, here the space which is occupied that element is not there at all. In case of visibility, the space occupied that element is left, and below that the rest of the elements are rendered. That's the difference between these two. Yeah, we talked about the character references in detail, and here I just talked about in detail again. And entity reference also we talked. You can read through it. Yeah. So this document structure elements also we discussed. Okay. Yeah. So let me just talk about this one. So then one of the important purposes for which meta tag is used is the HTTP echo. So only if you are doing like say very detailed advanced web programming, only then you require it. So that's when you can specify the expires tag, and then you can specify the character set, okay, and so on. So here using, let's say you don't want Google to crawl your web page and index your web page, that you can specify using the here HTTP equivalent robots tag. So no index, no crawl, means your page will not be crawled. So you can see here no index, no follow. So use, basically these are the directives to the web crawlers, like Google web crawler. So yeah, that's when you can use these meta tags with HTTP equivalent headers. Yeah, whenever a web server sends a response to the browser, the message will look like this: HTTP version 1.1, and then 200 means everything is okay, means successfully delivered the web page, and okay is the basically the success or failure, and actually the page will follow that. Yeah, so next element we talked about, which is present, is script element. So this will demonstrate that. Basically, script element like here. So you, preferably it should be there in the beginning, but alternate ways of using script tag, I'll talk about it little later. So note that script tag will have an attribute called source, and source. So JS stands for JavaScript, JS, JavaScript directory, and within directory you can specify JavaScript code. You can go and see here, in my directory I have a JavaScript folder, within that I have a JavaScript folder, sorry, file. So this is my JavaScript, wherein I just have one statement, JavaScript statement, which is welcome to front-end web development. And the way to link it from this HTML page to that is using the script attribute and then source. So let me render this page. So here. As soon as you render the page, since it sees the JavaScript code, browser executes the code and it displays this alert message. You see it? So I'll demonstrate once again. So I'm just refreshing it. The first that JavaScript code is executed, and only once you close it or click it, just OK, then the rest of the page will get executed, rendered. That's because I use a hidden property here. So remove the hidden and execute. So now you see popped up, and then rest of the page is executed. Is that clear? So whenever any page is rendered in a web browser, as soon as the JavaScript code is seen by the browser will stop rendering the page and execute the JavaScript code. And once it completes executing the JavaScript code, then it will proceed with rendering the rest of the content. So this is a very important concept, because if you don't understand how the JavaScript gets executed in a browser, if you place the JavaScript code wrongly in HTML page, then you will not have a very good user experience. So you can see, read through this here, where you can place script elements, and you can just play with them as well by putting inside and outside HTML and so on. So another way of specifying it is, so let us say if you don't want to do it using this source tag, okay, so you want to give in this page itself. So then what you need to do is, you need to copy that page, that JavaScript code, put it here. So welcome to Edureka. So now, this is a JavaScript code. Now we are embedding inside the HTML page itself. And let's render it. See here? And the rest of the page gets executed. So I'll just change it to Edureka, and you can see that getting changed. So you can see welcome. This is the pop-up which is there in the JavaScript, and then the page gets rendered. Hope that is clear. So you can just see where all you can place the script. So we'll come out. When we are doing the JavaScript coding, at that time we'll come back to this script element again. Just for the completeness sake, I put it here. And similarly, if you remember, styles. So we use the styles inside this my style sheet. So rather than doing it there, you can remove it completely. And I'll remove this as well. And you can specify using style here. And then style. And on paragraph, you can say paragraph. And let's say this paragraph, currently it's green. I will say color red. And then eBrow render it. Note that external reference to the style sheet, I removed it. So now it's changed to red. So this is another way, using style element, you can specify the styling of elements. But it's highly recommended that you should put in a separate external CSS file or external JavaScript file, both styling and JavaScript code. So we did talk about this title element. So title, whenever you give a title here, whatever you given here in the title body, so that get displayed here. You see here the tab, so that gets. So I'll just remove it. Web dev. So now I change the title. Just notice here, Edureka demo. So that changed to web dev. So that is the purpose of title. Here at the end, for each of the modules, I have given the references. You can visit these URLs, and you can read up to know more about what we discussed in all these four modules. So there is, I mean, few things which I would like to refer. There is something called, I mean, mentioned that W3 Schools is one of the good websites which gives some easy to understand information. Like for example, you can go here www.w3schools. Okay. So here you can see, you can read about HTML, CSS, JavaScript, and so on. Like if you want tutorials, click on tutorial. If you want reference of tags, particular tag, you can click on tag. Like for example, you click on the tag reference. Here on the left hand side, it lists all the tags which are defined in the HTML. You can see. Like for example, if you want to read about a paragraph tag, click on paragraph tag here. And this page displays how to use an example. And if you want to try to yourself, click on that. It will open a page. And here you can just say this. You can modify here itself. You can play with it. Reka. You can modify here itself and then see the result. On the right hand side, it will get modified. If you don't want to install, the browser and then, so some of the things, you can try it out here itself. This is one of the good sites. So this, like that, you can read about it, more about it, what are the attributes and so on. Okay. And so next, another thing which I would like to mention is about, this is a WG.org. This is the what W working group which I was mentioning in the beginning. So this is the official website of what WG group, which is also authentic and reliable source for HTML5 and CSS3. And another thing is, tutorials point is also another good place. And W3C, World Wide Web Consortium, this is our official website, w3t.org, where you can go and read upon in more detail about the HTML.